So I'll just provide an overview of the workshop, how things are going to be. So here is the schedule. So I'll provide an overview of the workshop, and there is also a clarification session. In fact, there are three clarification sessions: today, tomorrow, as well as Friday, where the purpose of the clarification session is, among the content that you have watched, if there is something you would like me to explain because you did not understand it, if it's something very simple, you meet me afterwards. But if it's something a little bit complicated, I will undertake it and I'll explain it to you so that you understand it better. We could also use the sessions to, I'll post some problems and you can work in groups, discuss it. This is the think, pair, share, which Professor Sridhar will also talk about. So basically, I'll pose a problem, you think for yourself, you discuss it with your neighbors, come up with a final solution, and then we'll discuss some of it. Like, I'll like to hear what your solution is, and then I will provide the correct solution. So that's how these clarification sessions will go on. So tomorrow I'm going to talk about, as I've already mentioned, about my experiences in using a flipped classroom here at IIT Bombay using this platform. And we have overall 5 lab sessions. So we have Monday afternoon, Tuesday afternoon, Wednesday is an entire lab session, both in the morning and the afternoon, and Thursday afternoon. So there are the labs, and then Thursday there are a few other talks. One is Professor Sridhar Iyer. He is a faculty in CSC department, so he will share with you some of the experiments he has done in teaching pedagogy for effective learning. And there is also another lecture by Professor Bhaskar. Well, he's my husband, as a wife. I roped him in to do one presentation. So he will provide you some tips on handling student projects, how to define projects, how to read papers, write presentations, that kind of a thing. Which so that's what he will do. And the final day, which is Friday morning, I'll provide you some information on how the main workshop has to be conducted. There's a logistics sessions where Dr. Mukta will also tell about how to handle some of the budget and other issues. After this, again, there's a course content clarification. And after this is we break in the afternoon. We will, so this is the afternoon sessions. As I said, they're all labs, but Friday afternoon is a valedictory function. So this is the time where the certificates will be distributed, as well as any kind of feedback you wish to give about the platform, this workshop, the lab sessions, whatever it is, I'll be available. Please, I mean, in fact, things improve only via feedback. So your feedback is very important. So don't underestimate it. Say, oh, what is there? Everyone is telling the same thing. So that's, for us, the quantity also, if many people tell the same thing, then that means it's an important problem which we prioritize and we are going to address it. So don't view your feedback as something chalta hai. No, it's very important to us. So please take your time. If it's important, just put your thoughts down. You can share it as a hard copy, face to face, whatever it is. Your feedback is extremely important to us. So please do give us feedback. So with that, so I'll give you a few additional information about, so that's the schedule. So a little bit about how labs are going to be conducted. So labs will be done in groups of 2. So please pair up with someone. I mean, if you already have friends, just pair up. Otherwise, make friends and pair up. In case you don't have a partner, we will assign you with one at the location of the lab. The labs, as I said, are a bit, I mean, if you already are familiar with some of the things, things may go on faster. But if you have not handled TCP dump, Wireshark, or whatever of these tools, then they may be a bit intimidating. So they're a bit, normally if someone with experience does this lab, they do finish within an hour. But if one and a half hours, but someone without experience, it can take a lot of time. So please be there at the labs. If necessary, if you finish, you can leave early, but do get started on time. The labs are spread across three rooms, NSL, OSL, and something called NSL NX. You can assemble at any of these places in case the computers get, they are occupied, then we will ask you to move to another location. So there may be some initial movement at the beginning, but from next lab on, once you decide you're going to be sitting here, just go to the same place, that way you don't have to move. So these labs have machines which are Linux Ubuntu based machines. You have to do a local login. The login is if you are in the location called NSL lab, the username as well as password is NSL user. If you are in the OSL lab, the username and password is OSL user. So the assignments are up on the BodhiTree platform itself. We already have logins. So you just access bodhitree.cse.iitb.ac.in and there is a new tab to your left. Under the workshop lab exercises, there is under FAQs, this tab is there. The first assignment has been placed up there, so get started. As I said, since the exercises can be dense, instead of exploring many things, focus on getting the thing done. Later you explore. So I think exploration is very important, but try to finish the exercise first before you explore. And I mean, needless to say, teaching only when you think you learn. So there are TAs available for to help you. Take the help of TAs only when you feel you're really stuck. Unless you really put in, try out different things, you don't quite learn. So labs, it's very important that you do things, experiment on your own before you take help. But there is help in case you're stuck, please make use of the TAs. So this is a new thing which typically by 5:15, I'll display the answers. So by 5:15, you finish your, try to finish up the lab by this particular time. After that, we will do this pairing. So you pair with your neighbor and exchange your answers. Both of you exchange your answers with each other. Sit as a group and discuss some of the issues you faced, or you could discuss the solutions, whether you have maybe you came up with a different way of doing it, you can tell, oh, I thought of this. So compare notes, discuss it, and the TAs also can help you in case you didn't understand something. They will be able to help you understand the answers as well. It's since the same lab you're going to conduct later at your remote center, it is important that you understand the nitty-gritty details, because later when you go there and someone asks you something, it's not nice to be stumped. So do ensure that you understand each and every aspect of the question thoroughly. If not, take the help of the TAs. So this is the first clarification session. As I said, there are three such sessions. So today's session, if you have any questions on any of these topics, I'll be happy to clarify any questions of any kind. If in case you don't ask me questions, I'll start to ask questions. Anything that confused you, which you like me to explain, I'll be happy to explain. Or in general questions on any, it doesn't have to be the content that was covered. Something outside also, if you have, if I know, I'll answer.
I have a doubt in matrix use in evaluation of the computer network. Throughput and good put, I have read somewhere. There is a good put as well. What is the difference between throughput and good put?
Okay, so it's again, many of these metrics, one point I wish to emphasize is they are to be calculated based on definition. So people will mean different things. Some may use good put for throughput, throughput for good put, whatever it is. So you have to be aware of the context and how it is defined before you do the calculation. Often good put is useful work done. So for example, if you are sending, let's say 500 bytes, and the 500 bytes you received, let's say in a duration of 1 second, throughput will be 500 bytes over 1 second. But if this 500 bytes carry some headers which take up, let's say, 100 bytes or 200 bytes, then the good put, which is basically the useful work that got done in transferring, because these headers are not actually delivering useful, I mean, they are useful in the sense that you need to implement the functionality, but they are not really carrying application level data. So that will be 300 over 1 second then. But again, as I said, people may view it, interpret it differently. It's a totally a function of, in the context, you need to read what good put has been defined. Different papers will define it differently. So it's a totally, but you have to, this is typically what is used, but as I said, it could vary. Someone else may define good put in some other fashion.
Good afternoon, madam. I'm Dr. S.A. Kulkarni. I wanted to know, is there any practical implementation of OSI model?
OSI model, there is... So it has been standardized, but it has not been implemented, just because I wouldn't say it hasn't been implemented. People did implement it at the very beginning, but it just didn't work out because the way they have defined some of the interfaces, the way they have defined some of the functionality didn't catch on. It felt that it was more complicated, and so no one started using it.
I read it in some of the literature.
X.25 network.
Yes.
And which was the standardization of last three layers. Like, can we quote it as an example of practical implementation of OSI? It was much prior to TCP/IP came.
Yeah.
It was used in public data networks in Europe and all.
Yeah. So, I mean, this is something I have to look up. I don't really know whether it is an actual implementation of OSI. I mean, Wikipedia is as good as me then. X.25 is typically used in that context.
Nearer to that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Interlayer communication.
Okay.
Actually, there are various layers in, say, TCP/IP model, data link layer and the internet layer. Mm-hmm. Though it is specified in many books that there is an interface between these two layers.
Yeah.
And even these interfaces can be reconfigured by the user. Though I tried many times in Microsoft Windows operating system that how I can find some interface where I can specify something, how can I reconfigure the interfaces of the two layers.
So just, I'm not sure I understood. You're talking about interlayer communication or interface communication?
Yeah, interlayer interface, because two layers define say interface where they are providing the services.
Yes,
means data link layer is providing the services to the internet layer.
Yes,
so is there is something in operating systems where user can see or administrator can see that how this interface can be reconfigured by the administrator?
So any of this functionality which is defining the interface between two layers, this is part of the kernel. So for example, TCP, so if you really want to change them, you need to dig into the kernel and change the kernel specifications. So if it comes as part of your kernel. So unless you change the kernel, you cannot really change it. So if you want something to be exposed to the application layer, which the kernel normally doesn't, then you have to go into the kernel, look at the particular module, expose that. So this will fall under kernel programming.
Means
so Windows, I have absolutely no idea because it's a closed system. I have rarely worked with Windows other than right now I use Windows just to record my videos because that software works in Windows. Other than that, I'm not familiar with Windows at all. If you're trying to do some of these things in Linux, you need to do kernel programming where, for example, at the data link layer, you want to expose something, you have to dig into the drivers. So you have to do driver level programming. If you want to expose something at the network layer, there are these IP tables, blah, blah, that kind of a thing. So you again have to dig into the kernel modules to make any changes. So anything you involve where the default kernel does not support and you want to expose additional parameters to the higher layers or do whatever, you need kernel programming to be able to do it.
There is no any kind of utility in Ubuntu from where directly we can do this.
Certain parameters, for example, you can, so for example, at the TCP level, whatever are the buffers that are, it's not quite so there are certain, it knows it will reserve certain amount of buffer space for an incoming connection. There is a default value for it. Now, if you want to change this default value, you can potentially do it through the socket call and some such things. But these are things, there is a default value, but you can change them based on exposure. Like, I mean, there are ways in which you don't really need kernel programming for that. But if there is something which is not exposed in this particular fashion, but you still want to change it, then you really need to get into the kernel. So for example, if you're dealing with a Wi-Fi driver and you want at the application level what the received signal strength is. Right, it doesn't, I don't know off late drivers, but earlier drivers never exposed RSSI stops at the link layer itself. But if you want to do it, then you have to write a procedure where you write a module within the kernel that is taking this data from the link layer, writing it into a file, and the application is now querying this file to get that data. So you do all this IPC community, so you have to follow some of the kernel communication to be able to get that information. Some things they expose which you can get, some if they don't, you need to dig into the kernel.
This is Dr. Suchismita from NIT Rourkela. Ma'am, regarding the service of data link layer, basically we have two layers, the LLC and the MAC, right? When you talk about the services, is it the service for both the layers or is it distinct for the MAC layer and for the LLC?
So actually this, when we talk about the data link layer, some standards, it's again a function of the standard, some standards bring about a clear separation between the LLC and the MAC. Some functionality, each standard defines LLC and a MAC, more or less. But some functionality, some MACs implement it at the LLC level, some same functionality, some other standards implement it at the MAC layer. So mostly the data link layer is technology specific because it varies from technology to technology. Ethernet will have a different thing versus Wi-Fi and so on. So it's totally up to the standard to define what functionality it will call LLC, what functionality it will call MAC. Typically LLC is something which is common across, like it'll deal with some kind of, for example, if you're doing reliable, some session management kind of a thing is managed at the LLC level. MAC will often look on the media access control issues. But sometimes that functionality for convenience is integrated as part of MAC.
So we take as a whole, ki this is the function
of
this.
Yeah, so when we say link layer, it's in general, at least at the teaching level, unless you are working on the standard and are contributing to the standard, at the teaching level, I prefer not to make any distinction. I'll just say link layer supports all these functionalities. And media access control is a terminology I use just to define the protocol that does media access control.
And basically for wireless, we give more focus on this MAC layer. Otherwise, we take as in general that DLL does all these things.
Yeah. And so in media access, because other things are like other aspects of it are taken care of LLC. MAC will deal with the CSMA CA. Yeah.
And when we talk about the error detection, the error control and flow control are the two services of DLL. So when we consider about error control, does it contain only error detection or simultaneously correction as well?
It again depends on standards. Some standards, for example, cellular standards do implement error correction where FEC is included as part of the standard. But Ethernet does not do, in fact, it doesn't do error correction. So it's totally a function of the standard. So link layer, as I said, what functionality is implemented is totally a function of the specific standard.
So when you teach the subject for the undergraduate students, when we talk about the DLL, should we go for the error detection or error control as a whole, or should we focus on detection separately and correction separately, or basing on, because they studied in general, computer networking.
Yes.
So in general, what should we focus on for teaching them?
So when I teach it more as a concept, independent, like link layer can support error correction, error detection. Error detection, these are the techniques. Error correction, these are the techniques. So okay. At the link layer, you need to support in certain, so we talk about the distinction between why, so I probably, I don't know if I uploaded this video, not all videos I have uploaded on the website because I wasn't sure whether there were some corrections had to be made in the video. So I talk often about why do we go for error detection versus correction. So there is a trade-off between both of them. So error correction, which probably I probably covered as part of the thing in the video. So you bring about that and thereby you'd say, okay, I should implement error detection, I should implement error correction because of this trade-off. Again, it's a trade-off piece. In certain situations, you want to do error detection. In certain situations, you want to do error correction. So both have to be implemented, not by the same standard. Different standards will implement different things. And then this is the concept behind error detection. This is the concept behind error correction.
Okay, one more last question, ma'am. Like for framing, we have different techniques, bit stopping, character stopping, all those things. For error detection, we have the different protocols, all those ARQ mechanism. And for this in flow control, we have the sliding window, stop and wait, all those things. But for the reliable data transfer, what basically the protocols or mechanism, how we define this one, reliable data transfer?
So reliable data transfer is, so when you talk about stop and wait and sliding window, these are all part of the reliable data transfer itself. As the name suggests, you want to transfer data in a reliable fashion. Mm-hmm. Now, in order to do this, there are different techniques. Like you could do stop and wait, which is not very efficient. Then you can move on to sliding window. All these are reliable data transfer itself.
Right.
Often flow control is an aspect of reliable data transfer, where you are trying to ensure that when you are transferring the data, you are not going to overwhelm the receiver.
Exactly.
So that's so when you talk about TCP, the distinction becomes even more clear, because TCP is a reliable data transfer protocol. Within the doing reliable data transfer, you also want to ensure two other things. One is congestion control, one is flow control. So
right.
Both are part of reliable data transfer. They are not separate from reliable data transfer.
Okay.
So when you do this, how do you support both these also as part of the protocol?
So for the data link layer, we can say that to have the reliable data transfer, we have these are the services and the mechanisms for us.
Yeah, so at the data link layer, reliable data transfer is done using stop and wait in this, but this the fact that you are manipulating the receiver buffers and sender buffers, through that you are managing the flow control aspect also. Because if you receive, for example, if you have RWS as I defined in my lectures set to something, you send more than that, it'll invariably drop. So the sender should be clever that it should know RWS is what is reserved, and it should not try to send more than RWS.
You can change the value of RWS?
The receiver, so again, I mean, yeah, receiver has certain amount of, so the link layer, as I said, a lot of the Ethernet and others do not implement. This is often implement, even the Wi-Fi also doesn't implement all this. So this is a more a concept. Some of them, maybe some other standard may implement it, but you have to look at the standard specifications. The implementation that exists is TCP, so I'll talk in the context of TCP, it's even there. So RWS, you can change the thing by, at the kernel, whatever, I mean, it's a parameter. So there are certain commands and the thing which, with root permission, you can change the amount of buffer space you are allocating to the receiver. That you can change through some commands.
So can we say that for having this reliable data transfer at the DLL, we have the different mechanisms? Can we conclude in that way, ma'am?
To support reliable data transfer at the link layer, mm-hmm. these are the protocols that are available. The slop and wait, which is not efficient, sliding window is an improved version of it. These are conceptual levels. When it comes to implementation, each standard will implement it in whatever fashion they want.
Yeah.
There will be implementation specific artifacts thrown on top of it. So then you have to focus, if you are talking about a standard, then you have to teach what the standard does. But mm-hmm. often as a teacher, I don't like to get into the standard specification because it's too narrow. Well, I mean, you should understand the concept. Why is it that this is used, this is not being used? Later you do whatever you want on top of it.
What is the difference between OSI model and TCP model? Mm-hmm. Just wanted to know that which model is used where.
Okay. So there is some history to this. Again, I may, to the very good extent, I'm right, but I wouldn't be surprised if someone says, no, you're wrong. I wouldn't be surprised. So the way, so in the initial days when people were trying to come up, this internet was at the beginning stages. So they figured out that they need to layer. And this object-oriented approach I was talking about, where which functionality to implement, where should we implement, how to design this entire communication infrastructure. So at that time, people were discussing So as part of the discussions, there was one group that had come up with the OSI, and in the research community, people were actually implementing it and doing certain, they were implementing the network layer functional. So originally there wasn't any distinction between the TCP and IP. Both were kind of merged into one thing and were implemented in that particular fashion. And OSI came up with this very nice concept with this should be like this, these should be the interfaces, these seven layers should be there, they should interact in this fashion. So it came about in that particular fashion. But in academia, where most of the research implementation, because all the internet had originated from MIT, Stanford, UCLA, these places. So these people had already implemented it in that particular fashion, and people started using it more and more, and they were. So finally, they realized as part of the implementation that some of these layers are probably not necessary, like session or presentation. And not only that, people who had actually taken OSI and implemented it as part of the thing, they were leading to, often when people implement different portions and they are to be compatible, you need to be very clear on what the interface is, because someone will be working on the transport layer, someone will be working on the network layer, someone is working on the application layer. So that model turned out to be too complex that implementations were not being very successfully used because they were running into a lot of problems. Whereas in academia, they followed this and they were doing well, and people were actually using it. So over time, that thing became outdated, and what the academia, which defined only five layers, and later in fact they separated out the TCP and the network layer more distinctly, and that's five layers took off. And from then on, we call it the internet TCP IP internet protocol stack to refer to the five layers that is actually used now. OSI, there was implementation, but it was never really used.
Is there any visualization tool to see all the functionalities of various layers? Like, because first when you start teaching TCP or OSI, people will start imagining, is there any visualization tool through which I can tell them this is the way it works?
So to some extent, when you run Wireshark or TCP dump, you actually will see the layering, that the layers that get, in fact, in the afternoon lab, you will be able to see. So you will see that, for example, you are downloading some packets from a particular website. Right, you see the packet, and for that particular packet, you will see all these things being added.
For example,
but you will only see it in the header format. You will not really see an action. So if you want to demonstrate some action, you need additional lab exercises to demonstrate each and every functionality.
For example, in TCP, this Wireshark, UDP, TCP, you can explain. Huh. Like session layer, all those things, it's difficult to visualize. And
there is no session layer implemented, so you can't even see it. So this, as I said, in the internet protocol stack, which consists of five layers, there is a presentation and session, which was OSI defined, but the regular things don't do. Those are incorporated as part of the application layer itself. So if you see it, you will see the functionality of session layer or presentation layer as part of the application layer itself. So email, for example, the way it displays text, that's part of the session layer itself. As defined by the session layer.
Ma'am, in reference to this slide, I have two questions. First one is that I have studied in number of books. Someone tells that TCP IP model have four layers. Mm-hmm. Someone have TCP IP layer have five models. So a theoretical concept which we should consider, this is my first question, four layer or five layers.
Okay.
And second question is that in data link layer, when a node want to send the frame to the next node, actually it needs the physical address of that, and for which it puts the ARP packet.
Yes.
In ARP packet, it puts the IP address of the next node. So my IP question, IP address of the next node.
Yes.
So from where it come to know what is the IP address of the next node? Because to collect the physical address, it need the IP address. From where it?
Okay.
Yeah.
So going with the first thing, whether it is four layers or five layers, so often, physical layer is often ignored just because it's assumed it is there, because without it, you cannot do anything. But that said, I would insist there are five layers, because when you talk about the wireless specifically, the physical layer varies from standards to standards significantly. So it's not like, for example, in the wired domain, maybe it's kind of a standard thing that they implement. Even there, in fact, even Ethernet, you have different physical layer the kind of cable you use varies, and based on that, the attenuation, whatever propagation. So I would say there are five layers, which is physical, data link, network, transport, and application.
Number of books specify that the name of this layer is host to network layer.
Huh?
Host to network layer.
Host to.
Host, H-O-S-T, host to network layer. Number of books specifies the name of this layer is host to network layer.
Which one? The physical layer they specify?
Physical layer plus the data link layer. This is combinedly.
So yeah, so it is possible that they do it because most standards, when they write the standard, so the network, the transport layer and the application layer are kind of not quite technology specific. They are common across. So everyone, whether I use Wi-Fi or I use Ethernet, my network, transport and the application layer, the technology that I'm using will very likely be the same. It's only the underlying Wi-Fi or Ethernet will change. So most standards specify the data link in combination with the physical layer. And this varies from technology. For example, Wi-Fi will specify its MAC as CSMA, CA, and the underlying physical layer as depends on OFDM or whatever it is. Ethernet will have again its MAC as CSMA, CD, and the physical layer as some Ethernet standard. So these things vary. This is very technology dependent. So often when they look at the thing, this two is, since it is technology dependent, can be clubbed together as one and say, okay, fine, this is something that is specified by the technology. So the technology will come up with its specifications, the functionality, and on top of this, the network transport and the application layer resides. I mean, it's a perception. I mean, we will five or four layers. I mean, you have to be clear. There is, in fact, I would say it is five because the kind of functionality a physical layer does is very distinct from the kind of functionality which a MAC layer does. And each standard does distinguish between these two layers. Clearly, because the physical layer will talk about the physical layer stuff, which is all about modulation, blah, blah. And the MAC layer will talk about how to access the media contents.
Ma'am, from my point of view, I got your point. Hmm. But number of times student asked that, sir, if I will put four layers, then examiner will cross my and will not give me marks.
What? Well, then
this
you should. But I mean, at a level, you should also convey to the students that it is the concept that is important. I mean, it's not what you're talking about is like a terminology thing. I mean, should I write four or five? But I mean, I don't really. Then it depends on what your syllabus defines.
In my university, generally, this questions comes of 20 marks. And if the student is at initial level telling that four layers means he don't know anything, cross this question. This is happening.
That has to change then. I mean, it should
because
change.
There are a number of books. Someone is specifying four layers, someone is specifying
five.
So even in standard books, it is.
But as I said, this is the reasoning behind it. I mean, that if you convey to the student, maybe they can write four or five layers based on the textbook and then give an explanation. I don't have a... So
my
going to
question.
Your second question, which is...
framing. Related to framing, when we want to send the frames to the next host.
So what is happening? So the way internet has evolved, this again has to do with the history of the way the things have evolved. So, I mean, I probably has mentioned this point, but let me repeat it again. All this devices that are implementing the internet protocols, they are automated. They cannot relate with names like we do. So for example, if I want to access google.com or whatever, it's there, it's a text form which you and me can relate. So the machines cannot relate to that. So one, definitely the first step is we have an address, which is, let's say, www.google.com, and we want to contact this particular server. Now I need to first find out what the, because the standard is, before any communication happens, you need to determine what the IP address of that particular machine is. Because from going from one host to other over many hops, IP is what is important. The MAC is not very important. MAC only serves in a local area. So you need to know the IP address because you don't know whether this guy is local or he's far away. So you need to get the IP address. So you need to get that IP address. So you use the DNS service. You specify to the DNS, this is the name I am familiar with, which is google.com, give me the IP address. So this service is independent. We talked about DNS. If you have not read it, you should go through. I mean, you should probably know what DNS does. But so you get the IP address from the DNS. Now, one node, when it got the IP address, it's going to assemble a packet.
I am asking it for the first time, because first time if you are configuring the DNS, even then it need the physical address of next machine to pass the packet.
So the next machine which it is always going to pass the address is, so again, even here, any machine before it even starts to communicate needs to know its own identity, which is its IP address.
My question is, when one machine want to send something to next machine, it is for first time, that as you told, key it for something domain, it will ask the DNS to bring the IP
address. No, even forget. So let me finish my statement and then you ask your question. Each machine has an identity. It needs to know what its IP address is. So when it is, this is the bootstrap time through DHCP. So when it gets its IP address, during this initial process, it gathers certain information. One is, what is its IP address? The second information it also gathers is, what is the subnet information? Which subnet am I part of? Which basically is defining what my local area is. Okay, this is the two pieces of information it will get. And the third piece of information it will also get is, if I want to contact with someone who is outside my subnet, who is the router I should contact with? So it gets the default IP address, it will get its own IP address, it will get what is the subnet, which is the 10.105.*.* whatever, that is my subnet. So this is the three pieces of information it is going to get. Without getting these three pieces of information, you really cannot communicate. You may do local communication, but you really cannot communicate to outside. Now, once you get this information, what is this telling? So now let's say you want to assemble a packet. You got the IP address of the packet through DNS. Now, the IP address, if it is matching your own subnet, that means it's a local thing to you. If it's Ethernet, you just broadcast, it'll go away. But if it is not matching, you know the IP address of the router. So you now take this packet, which is the IP packet, where the destination is whatever Google, but you know the IP address of your router. More importantly, you know the MAC address of the router also, because you can use ARP to get the MAC address of your router. But often this is also stored automatically within your thing. All you do in this particular case is you take this packet, pass it to your router. So the packet will have the destination as the Google's IP address. And this is encapsulated within a MAC level packet whose destination MAC will be the router's MAC. And you pass it to the router. Now, once the router gets this packet, it'll do the same thing. It'll forward it further, because the network protocol will ensure the distance vector or whatever who it should pass it to. And this keeps going in this particular fashion.
Ma'am, now my one more question. Say in local area network, it is the one PC. And somewhere it will be the proxy server which is connecting to with the WAN. How, because if I am not using the DHCP, administrator will assign the IP addresses to each and every machine.
Will assign not just IP addresses, he will assign subnet mask, he will have to assign the default router also. All three have to be assigned, without which nothing can work. So if you do the Windows configuration, whatever, there are fields for this. Without entering these fields, you cannot communicate. If it's manual, you have to enter. If it's automatic, DHCP will tell you. Some of these, again, you will see in the lab.
So on the basis of the gateway, it gets the IP address of that server?
Which server?
Say, one is the proxy server, local area network, and there are number of machines that are...
Proxy server, you configure yourself manually. So, for example, in IITB, we have our own proxy server. So, I get into the browser settings, hit use proxy. I specify the name of the proxy each user is specifying. The default router and the DNS server information also, it will come through the DHCP. Who is your DNS server? You'll see all this as part of the lab. So, once you finish the labs, I think many of these things will be clear.
Thank you.
Myself, Tapos Maiti, from Kolaghat Engineering College, RCIIT 1336. My question is related to that layer 3 switch or router, whenever a packet came to the router or it as it go upwards in every layer, data link layer and network layer, header part is removed. And when this packet is delivered for the output destination, actually, again, header is added at the network layer. My question is, who takes the responsibility to take that transfer and adding that header, either the network driver software or some application software?
If it is a network layer functionality, only the network layer will handle. Applications do not come into play at all. So if it's a router, within the router itself will have three layers. One will be the physical layer, one will be the link layer, one will be the network layer. So as a packet goes up, the physical layer will give it to the top layer, which will remove the link layer headers, pass it to the network layer. Network layer will now figure out, okay, typically routers have multiple interfaces. The network layer will figure out, okay, I have to send this packet on, let's say, interface 1. So it will pass it to the link layer corresponding to interface 1, which will then again add the link layer header corresponding to that interface, and then it will go through the physical layer of that particular interface, and then it will go further. So all this is implemented as part of, I mean, if you are converting your PC into a router, these are all implemented again as part of the kernel. Often routers, when you're implementing the routers, many of these functionalities, there isn't, so a lot of the functionality is implemented in hardware. So for example, because to increase the speeds, everything is like an FPGA or whatever, you cannot do any processing delays have to be kept at a very minimal. So things are just done extremely fast and it pushes out. So there's no software portion also in some of these functionalities. Everything is hardware. They just get all the interpretation of the headers is often done in hardware and it pushes it forward.
So then what is the role of the driver software then?
The driver software again depends. So drivers are typically used in the context of the data link layer. So for example, the role of Wi-Fi driver will be to implement the CSMA CA. So even in CSMA CA, some portions of it is implemented in software, some portions of it is implemented in hardware. Because for example, you need to send an ACK right after some duration, which is 10 microseconds. If you say I will implement in software, you cannot maintain 10 microseconds. So that has to go bang after you receive the packet. You have to interpret, do some check that the packet is properly received, which is again implemented in hardware. If it is properly received, it will send an ACK right after 10 microseconds. These cannot be implemented in software level. But that said, for example, you get a packet, if it's you want for it to, even the contention aspect also, figuring out what the timers are and when they fire, all that is also likely implemented, portions of it is implemented in hardware. But if you are trying to do, for example, in Wi-Fi, there are beacons that are sent, all those beacons are assembled as part of software and then passed to the hardware for them to be sent on time. So certain functionalities implemented in hardware, some functionalities implemented in software. So it's a function of the specific technology again.
And my second question is, in every frame there is a CRC part added at the sender side actually. So in the CRC part, normally CRC polynomial is employed or some other error detection mechanism is imposed?
So CRC is an error detection algorithm. So it helps you detect errors if there are any. I didn't understand. So it's again standard specific. Most standards do implement CRC. There are some standards probably don't implement CRC. They may have their own proprietary technology or whatever it is to do error detection.
That means about checksum is also some another.
At the network layer, you do internet checksum. Yes. Yeah, so there are different, so for example, at the network layer, the error detection is done via checksum. So that is something it is implemented. At the link layer, some technologies, not all do CRC. Some technologies use CRC to implement it.
Myself, Rajesh Thakur from SGSIT Indore. My question is related with the DSCP. My question is, why the response by the DSCP server is broadcasted at link layer?
If you are dealing with a host who does not have IP address to begin with, in fact, it depends. Sometimes it is not quite a broadcast. It is unicast also. It is a function of whether, what is the status of the particular host. Now, if you are starting out with no IP address at all, the only way you can receive the reply is if it were broadcast, because there is nothing you can target the thing. But if you are already have an IP address and you are renewing your lease, then it will come.
I am considering if suppose the request is sent by the host to the DSCP server. Now my question is, why this is broadcasted at link layer? No IP, not a matter. Because the client has sent the unicast request to the server at link layer. So there may be a unicast response from the server at link layer, not network layer. Because the server knows the MAC address of the client.
No, you are assuming that the DHCP server is on the same subnet as the client that is requesting, which need not be the case. DHCP server may be some other location. It may cover many subnets, in which case often this goes via relay. So you go via a relay to the DHCP server, in which case, I mean, the DHCP server really cannot broadcast. So DHCP, so for example, if like something like IIT Bombay, where for whatever reason we have a scarcity of addresses, which is not within, because we use a private IP address, it's not true, but it is possible that I might write one DHCP server for CSE, EE, math, whatever, in which case it's residing someplace. You don't typically want to put one DHCP per small subnets, because then managing the IP address is kind of, you just want one central location where it's managing many places, in which case it's not in the same subnet. If it's not in the same subnet, it's...
But if the DHCP server receives the request by some relay, in that case, the response by the DHCP server is unicasted to the relay only.
Yes,
but my question is a different one. Suppose, okay, if the, again, I can consider the relay, the broadcasting, by the broadcasting of the response is done by the DHCP relay in the subnet or in the VLAN of the source client.
Okay,
at link layer only. Only at link layer. I'm not considering the network layer.
Okay. So there are, a few reasons, which I thought I had asked this question also. But in any event, so there could be multiple DHCP servers also. So it's not that you are going, so for example, 3-4 subnets may be served by multiple DHCP servers just for redundancy fault tolerance purposes. So often when you are when you do a request, you are asking for an address, many of them may reply. Often when you're talking about the response being broadcast, it is to convey the information that I have already offered something to it and this guy may act on it, or so the fact that there is what is it called, an acknowledgement, it's DSCP, it's not like two way, after that you have to then again say yes, I'm kind of accepting what you have given,
same address.
So I guess the point you're trying to make is it's possible that you could implement it without without having to broadcast by varying the parameter. But this is true for many protocols. Why do they do in a specific fashion? I mean, there may be 2-3 methods of doing it. And it's just that broadcasting is giving information to the other guys that something is happening, and you can maybe log it better and figure out what is happening in terms of DHCP and request response pair and all. But maybe you can potentially do it just by unicasting, because you already know what the MAC address is, so you could potentially directly contact. It depends upon some ARP, for example, some of the ARP cases like gratuitous ARP and all, there are kind of unicast things are also done. So sometimes, this is common across, when you especially look at your implementations, there is no reason why they do it. It's one of the methods of doing, so they just do it as a, there may be some other reasons like this in terms of debugging or something else that helps.
For the same thing, in the RFCs, it is also mentioned that it is broadcasted.
Yeah. Yes, because broadcast works, it's not going to hurt you. And broadcast typically gives additional information to other entities which are kind of monitoring the flow of packets to see what is happening with respect to the DHCP. Maybe if the other server sees that it has already been offered, maybe it doesn't have to offer. So if some other DHCP server replied before you, your own reply, then it doesn't have to offer an IP address anymore. So it will stop. Some such things can be happening.
This is Shadab from CDGI. Just two or three questions from my side. First of all, whenever we study this computer network subject, we study two models, ISO/OSI model and TCP/IP model. Mm. And then we study ISO/OSI model is not practically implemented and TCP/IP is the practically implemented model. Do you think that we need another model, or in other words, we can say what are the limitations of TCP/IP model? My first question is this.
Okay.
And second question is this, error detection is one of the function at the data link layer, and it is one of the function of the transport layer also. So what is the difference between these two layers in error correction?
Okay.
And can we apply the same methods of the error correction what we studied in data link layer at the transport layer also? And third question is that, which is your favorite book in computer networking?
First question is, in fact, that is one of the questions I personally wanted to ask you, which is, in fact, let's view it as an exercise. So we have glorified the advantages of layering. I said modular design, it has reusability, code reusability, and abstraction of layers, blah, blah. I've told a lot of good things about layering. Is there any disadvantage to layering? So I guess kind of relates to your question. So TCP/IP layer, OSI was not used, let's forget about it. TCP/IP, the way things have worked out as layering, are there any disadvantages to this concept of layering? So before you, I just want you to spend some time thinking, maybe discussing also. In another 2 minutes, I will take answers from you. So this is So let's finish this exercise. So my question to you is, what are the disadvantages of layering? Discuss, just spend 2-3 minutes, and then I'm going to take answer. Think a little bit about what the disadvantages of layering potentially are. Go ahead.
Ma'am, one of the disadvantages is overhead, additional overhead, because we have to add header and trailer. So that is the one of the, we are adding some complexity, additional packets. So that is the one disadvantage.
Okay.
And
okay, so let me, in the interest of, so one disadvantage of layering is there is a processing overhead. So earlier, if you want to send something in one place, you could add whatever you want and then kind of push it off. But now, for example, each layer, when it is handling a packet, will have to do a memory read, do something, and write back to the memory. And then the next layer will again pull it, do something, write back. So there's lot of packet keeps moving from layer to layer is basically results in implementation, lot of reading from the memory, writing back to the memory and so on. So this tends to increase the processing delay of a particular packet, especially the more the number of layers, that means the more the delay is. Any other disadvantage?
It increases the resources cost.
Yeah, it's kind of related in the fact that the
additional overhead requirements for better processing for providing quality of services, like.
You're talking about the overhead cost itself, right? The fact that you're adding more and more.
I'm telling
headers.
About the second disadvantage, that we have to use much more powerful machines, because then only it is possible that we can provide good processing and provide quality of services.
Yeah, that is what it's related, because you are increasing more processing delay. If you want to reduce it, you have to throw more power at it.
So it increases the cost of the machines also.
I think it's dependency and compatibility. When new standards are being added, so each layer is dependent on the previous layer. So if there's one problem in one layer, the upper layer is dependent on that.
No, this is precisely why that's one of the advantages of layering, is that what they do is they freeze the interface. Interface cannot change. Only the functionality within a layer can change. So in fact, the advantage of layering is for example, the network layer has been defined and now you move from Ethernet to Wi-Fi, you're not changing anything at the network layer. That interface is standardized. You just change the link layer from Ethernet to Wi-Fi.
I want to know something about indirect layer. it is not possible to know. For example, application layer cannot come to know what is happening in the data link layer and network layer. That is also one of the drawbacks.
Yeah. So another big disadvantage is what we call you can do cross layer optimization. In fact, this is an area of research specifically in wireless networks, because you do want information to be passed on from, let's say, the link layer to some of the higher layers. Let me give an example. So for example, when you're choosing the network path, right, you may want to know what the bit error rate on a specific link far away is. Like if it's your own link, you can get that information because you're directly in contact with your link layer. But the link layer that is five hops away is not going to give information to the network layer, which is five hops this side, that it is experiencing this much loss rate, because you don't permit peer-to-peer communication is only between the link layer that is there to this link layer that is here. It will not communicate with the network layer that is residing about the link layer of, let's say, host one. But if you had that information, maybe you would have selected your network path better. Okay. So there are things like this which you can do based on cross-layer optimization, which layering makes it very difficult. So in wireless, when you move, you try to no more maintain strict layering. You do permit inter-layer communication, which doesn't follow the strict procedure.
Hello, yes. Ma'am. We can easily snoop the layers.
Huh?
Hack the layers.
Snoop the layers.
Yeah. We can hack the layers.
That is only within your own machine. You cannot hack. For example, let's say the example I was giving is, let's say there is host one, there is host two, host one, router two, router three, and router three link layer is experiencing some losses. How would you get this information on host one network layer, even if you whatever hack? You can hack within your own machine. But I'm saying hacking is violating the layering principle anyway. I mean, that is what wireless networks typically do. You do hack it such that you don't maintain the strict layering, because it has a disadvantage. In the interest of time specific to this question, if you have to add something which I have not covered, which is cross-layer optimization, it cannot do with, this is one of the disadvantages. There are many examples of cross-layer thing. I don't want you to go into the examples. If you understand the concept, that's fine. And the overhead. If you have any other point.
Madam, another drawback is related to the, since these layers has got a precedence constraint, so cascading aborts of packets is possible. So that is a disadvantage of layering mechanism.
What cascading of?
Cascading aborts of packets. Like if one layer has committed one mistake of processing of packets, and that is processed further, so it happens like you have to abort that packet because of not correct process by the preceded layer.
But that one, to some extent, that is why we have all these error detection kind of at each layer, such that at each layer, if you do detect, you kind of drop the packet then and there.
But that is going to increase overhead once again.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, yeah, it will. Yeah, it will increase the overhead for you to implement this additional functionality. Yes.
Reliability. If more number of layers, then our system is going to be less reliable.
Yeah, I think this relates to his second question, so I will get to that point. So what was your second question? Can you repeat once more?
Is error detection is one of the function of data link layer.
Yeah,
and error detection is one of the, error correction is one of the function of transport layer.
Transport layer doesn't do error correction. It does. Okay, fine. Let me rephrase. So I guess the question we are moving on to the next question, which is some functionality, let's say reliable data transfer, where basically you are doing error detection and what I will call error recovery. Error correction has a specific note. So let me distinguish three terms. One is error detection, which is detecting some packet is in error. Error correction is a method where you add redundant information into the packet itself such that the receiver can correct the error without anything else coming from the sender. Error recovery is a mechanism where often it is used in the sense that error correction also is doing error recovery, but the typical usage is once you detect something is an error, you contact the sender is going to retransmit the packet. This is not error correction. This one is error recovery, as I call it. But error correction is also a form of error recovery. But let me distinguish in the sense that TCP, the transport layer, does this ARQ kind of a mechanism, automatic repeat request. It's like it gets the packet back from the sender. Now the question is, which layer should implement this functionality? Do you implement it at the link layer? Should you implement it at the transport layer? What is to be done? Now, there is this seminal paper in networking called the end-to-end arguments. The exact title, I don't know, but if you search end-to-end arguments in networks, you should get hold of this paper. So what this thing talks about is, if there is certain functionality that you want to implement as part of this entire computer network, like for example, routing is a functionality, media access control is a functionality, just like that, if you want to implement this reliability as a part of the functionality, which layer should you implement it? Do you implement it at the link layer? Do you implement it at the network layer? Do you implement it at the transport layer? Or do you implement it at the application layer? So what this paper argues is, you should always implement it at the highest layer possible from the protocol stack, where highest layer means physical layer is the lowest, highest layer is the application layer. The reason the paper gives is that, suppose you implement it at the link layer and not at any of the higher layers. I'll say I will implement reliability at the link layer. In other words, I will ensure that a packet, when it goes from point host A to host B, if it got lost, I will retransmit the packet and somehow ensure that it will get to host B. Now, what can potentially happen is, fine, this packet got all the way to host B. Now, the host B network layer, while it is processing the packet, it could corrupt it or it could drop it. Then who is going to recover this packet? It's now the application layer has not seen this packet now. So applications are the ones who are handling, in fact, all this communication functionality is to support the needs of the applications. They know best as to what is happening to them, because whether network layer fails, link layer fails, any layer fails, the application will finally get to know, because it didn't receive whatever it was intended to receive. So the best place to implement any functionality is at the highermost layers. Because whatever you do, for example, you talk about duplicate packet suppression. Let's say you implemented the link layer. Now what if your transport layer, when it is doing its functionality, duplicated the packet? Now, if you implement it here, the application is now going to receive duplicate packets. So this is the concept between the end-to-end arguments. So the higher up you implement, the best it is. So when it comes to reliability, the way things are is, but this is a good argument to say where the functionality should be implemented. But certain situations, it is important to implement the functionality at the lower layers also. Otherwise, your performance is going to take a major hit. So for example, let's say you're sending packets and at the link layer, the loss rate is rather high. So it is kind of dropping the packets. Now, if you don't recover them at the link layer, you are not going to react to them until they reach the end and the other endpoint communicates. So this adds a lot of delay in the communication. So it's an optimization thing. So sometimes if loss rates are not bad, implement at the higher layer. If the loss rates are high, implement it at the lower layer also. It's not implement only at the link layer. Implement it at the lower layer also, in addition. So when we teach, we follow a lot of, at least I refer to 2-3 textbooks. Peterson and Davey is it's written with a systems approach, so it's kind of more hands-on. So that's what we used to. Kuros and Ross and Peterson and Davey, both of which I kind of use interchangeably. Other than this, rest of the textbooks I have. Tannenbaum, I know many people use, but I thought it focuses more on the lower layers. It's not quite a systems. When you do a lot of hands-on implementation kind of a thing, I find these two are more geared towards that than Tannenbaum. Seems more of a theory to me.
Huh? Ma'am, can you spell the name of the publishers?
Peters, I don't know. Computer Networks at top-down approach is Kuros and Ross. The other is Computer Networks systems approach is Peterson and Davey. Anyway, I'll put up these. In fact, I should have put up. I will put up on the website itself. I realized that I didn't put up. I'll put these books up. Okay. Names of the books, that is, not the
details. My question is that first question. Can we exclude the network or IP layer while we are going to communicate within a LAN and all the computers are connected with the switch only?
So again, the way things have evolved right now, as far as in theory, yes. In practice, no. Just because your machine does not know how to communicate without an IP address.
Actually, the communication in hop to hop is basically based on the MAC identification, MAC address.
So yeah, I agree. That is what I said. In theory, yes, you can communicate. But as I said, the way things have evolved, a machine needs, it doesn't know, I mean, it needs an IP address before it can communicate, because that's how things have evolved and it expects an IP address for it to communicate.
Ma'am, second question is, what is the difference between simulation and emulation? That means simulator and emulator.
Okay. Simulation is basically where it's a piece of code that you use to, so typically, for example, NS2 simulator that you're going to see is an event-driven simulator. So whatever functionality you want to implement, so for example, you generate a packet, it creates an event. This packet now has to go to the other end, it creates an event of a reception. So it kind of is simulating the flow of packets in that particular fashion. Emulation is where you use existing, like for example, if you already have TCP as part of your system and you want to use the TCP behavior, that is the kernel code that TCP already has, and you want to use this to feed it into some other simulator or to mimic the actual TCP behavior. But at the same time, it's not a real life. You're not actually using an implementation testbed. You're using the kernel code and doing something on top of it to get some results. So anything that involves actual implementation and you are kind of doing will be an emulation of.
Consequently, there is NS3 has been released since 2007 and it's very good. I have working since last 3 years. They have release a version that is called the Network Stack Cradle.
Yeah.
NSC.
Yes.
And that's work the same.
NSC is the same thing. So what you do is your network simulator runs a TCP code. So often as part of the network simulator, there is TCP code someone wrote, and that is doing the behavior of whatever TCP, Reno, Tahoe, whatever. But the implementation, which is Linux, Unix or Linux specific implementation, will be much different from that particular code NS2 provided. And often the behavior when you do simulations is going to be different from the Linux versus the NS2 or NS3 provided code. But if you want to capture real-time behavior where you want your packets to go through the protocol stack and only at some point enter your simulation, you can use the Cradle to do that. So you actually generate, so your packets are actually going through your protocol stack, and finally at some point, before they are exiting at some point at the network layer or the link layer, wherever you want to capture, from that point on you feed them into your simulator. Then you can mimic multi-hop networks, whatever it is, and again at the end point you take it and again pass them up the networking protocol stack to be analyzed at the application layer or the TCP layer.
Last question. I will try to give the answer of my colleague, that is called the why DHCP is broadcast. Actually, to achieve the higher reliability, and all the media is working on the sharing mode. So whenever it broadcasts, so other can also listen and record the IP and MAC pair for further communication. As I think, DHCP broadcasting rather than unicasting. Secondly, the question.
Okay, that I don't. ARP is what? ARP does the mapping. DHCP, I don't think any others listen to DHCP. As far as I am aware, they do not listen to the DHCP messages and act on them. ARP, they act. ARP is a given that they act. Yeah.
Last question, what is jitter actually?
Okay, jitter is again another metric which I have not covered. So this is more, it makes more sense in the context of videos. So what matters in a lot of this video audio is the interspacing between two packets. So for example, you send packet 1, packet 2 separated by, let's say, 50 milliseconds. You want the spacing to be maintained at the receiver ideally, but often the spacing will vary. So it may go by, once it may be separated by, so you are sending a stream of packets, each separated by 50 milliseconds. For proper playback of the video, you want the spacing to be roughly maintained. But what jitter, why you do you measure jitter is sometimes the spacing is 100 milliseconds, sometimes the spacing is 20 milliseconds. So it kind of varies over time. This results in pauses and stalls in the video if the jitter is, like if the spacing is not maintained, because the way videos plays at bank at this time, it needs the packet to display. If it's not coming, then it results in a stall. So jitter tends to capture the inter-packet spacing, whether it is being preserved or not.
Present day, we are seeing that more and more security is trying to be incorporated in the higher layers. For example, the application layers. People are going for software-defined security in that case. So I just want to, I have a small doubt, because as we are trying to work more on the application layers, on the other, we are trying making it more vulnerable. For example, for the past 30 years, we are thinking like TLS, SSL are all the secure protocols, and recently it is again exploited, and so on. People are using the legal HTTP traffic to exploit the downlayer activities as well. Mm-hmm. So even though we know that when you're going for more and more software-defined protocols, we are actually making more and more loopholes to be exploited, then why we still stress more that we should work on the higher layers?
Okay, this is a security question, which I'm not an expert in security, but still let me answer. So as I said, the end-to-end arguments that I was mentioning about, so the best form of security you can have is application to application, if provided you are very confident of the application developer that he has done the right job in implementing security. So for example, you want to send securely something from one host A to host B. Ideally, the end-to-end arguments say that wherever if you implement at the lower layers, then there will be vulnerability at the higher layer. So ideally, you should implement it the highest layer of the protocol stack, which will be the application layer. And that is what majority of the current thing also does. So for example, if you're sending something and there is Wi-Fi, and Wi-Fi being a broadcast, then you can potentially snoop on the packets and do. But if you're doing application layer security, you can't really do anything about it because it's encrypted. So that way, application layer security is a good mechanism to have. But what often happens is people who are implementing application layer security, this is not like one standard body. Everyone comes up with their own applications today, email, tomorrow, some other. There are a lot of web browsers, whatever it is. Application is a, there are tremendous number of applications. Now you need to trust them that they have done a good job of implementing their applications in a secure fashion. So for example, recently there was something about a vulnerability in SSH, which like it's a huge thing. All Facebook, everyone was like talking about it. So if there is no, so one level is not enough. So if you really want a reliable communication where you don't quite trust the applications to have done a good job, it's important to do it at the, so often you do at Wi-Fi level, the link layer, because many applications probably don't do at the application layer. So for those applications that are not doing it, it's good at least some level of security you're providing at the link layer. At the network layer, there is IPsec, which again is kind of a secure thing. So as far as security is concerned, one is often is not enough because of the fact that you don't trust them to do the right job. So you try to do it at multiple levels, and not all use up security at the application level. Even then, if you really want to somehow provide an added feature, you try to do it at the network layer and the transport layer. If it's a security question, I would say let's take it outside, just because this is not the focus of the workshop.
I have two questions. Ma'am, first of all, in physical layer, up to what extent we should discuss the encoding mechanism for the student purpose, up to what extent we should explain the encoding. And second question is, we can't add the new functionality in layer architecture, then it's advantage or disadvantage? Because some student think that it's advantage for the layer architecture, and some student argues, no ma'am, it's a disadvantage for that we can't add new functionality. So explain, it's an advantage or disadvantage.
Okay, so related to the first question, physical layer, as I said, if you're teaching a wireless course, I would say you probably have to spend a lot more time at the physical layer because there's a lot of stuff happening at the physical layer. Wireless is more or less the first three layers are, there is some changes specific to wireless, but most of the action is at the media access and the physical layer. So I do tend to go a little bit more. But for regular computer networks, whatever I have covered, some they should have some idea of what's happening to the bits when it goes on the wire. So whatever topics, the three topics I have said is, in fact, I normally also talk a little bit about modulation also, the passband modulation, just so that they know that in wireless at least something else is happening. But often whatever I've given, the three videos I've said, is more or less what I cover at the physical layer. Now when you talk about functionality at whether at, you cannot, the concept of layering is that if you want to add some additional functionality at a given layer, you don't have to touch the other layers. You just need to make changes to that specific layer. So that is the advantage of layering, in that you're not touching anything else. You're just touching that specific thing. But I don't know what you mean by disadvantage, because, well, I don't know if this is what you mean. Once something is standardized, like for example, Wi-Fi is standardized and you're following a specific standard, it's not easy to add any more functionality. It's frozen. The standard is frozen. But often the standards versions comes. For example, in Wi-Fi itself, you started with 802.11b, g, a, n, e, s, blah, blah, blah. It keeps on going. It's a huge number that goes on. So over time, if there is a functionality which people find is extremely useful, that it is important that the standard have, they come with up in a new version and add it in that new version. And then and again, it kind of takes over. So over time, it keeps getting updated, so on and so forth. Lunch break, its time is up.